Welcome to my talk. My name is Theresa, and I'm going to present you my research prototype, which is about managing multiple network interfaces in user space on Linux. So I am a researcher and PhD student at TU Berlin, and I'm at the Internet Network Architectures Group with Professor Anja Feldmann. And this research that I'm presenting now is joint work with my colleague Philip Teasel. We have been developing the prototype for about 4 to 5 years. So yeah, it's all research code. But yeah, the scenario that I want to talk about is about a multi-access client. So we got an end device like a notebook that is running Linux, and it has multiple network interfaces, and it's connected to different access networks over these interfaces. Like, for example, one is LTE and one is Wi-Fi, like with an LTE stick. It could also be Ethernet and Wi-Fi. But the point is that the client can now reach the internet or some server on the internet over both these interfaces. So usually, like if you're on a smartphone, usually Wi-Fi would be preferred over LTE. It's usually the default, but actually it's not always better in terms of performance. So there has already been a research paper from 2014 where these researchers have measured the Wi-Fi and LTE performance in terms of download bandwidth and also like latency. And they found that in about 40% of the cases, LTE was actually better than Wi-Fi, like where they just had lots of samples from some smartphones that were connected to Wi-Fi and LTE and basically in the same place at the same time, comparing their performance. So yeah, they found that LTE is often actually better than Wi-Fi in terms of performance. And so it suggests that maybe there is not always just one default interface that we should use while ignoring the other one. So my research is basically in the scenario, which one would you pick? How do you pick the better one? What is even the better one? Or maybe can you use both at the same time? So right now, let's say we have this laptop. It has an interface called WLAN0 connected to a Wi-Fi network. It has a PPP0 connected to some cellular network. And now one of them is going to be the default interface and the other one basically never used. Which one is the default? I guess it depends on the routing configuration of the system. And there is some system-wide static default route, usually. Like, it's very simple. You look at the routing table, and then there's a default route, and you just use it. And so one way where you could make use of the other interface as well is that you configure policy routing. So you configure two routing tables, one over the WLAN interface, one over the PPP interface, and then you can configure routing rules. So for example, if the application explicitly specifies one IP address of your configured addresses as a source, then it would go over this particular interface. So for several applications, you could say, please always bind to that IP address, and then it would go over this interface. So the problem with this is, okay, so first let's take a look at the socket API, which is what many applications are using when they are accessing the internet. So first they would resolve a name with getAddReInfo, just putting in a host name and getting back one or more IP addresses of the server that they're trying to connect to. Then they set up a socket with the socket call, and then optionally, they can bind the socket to one of their local IP addresses. So here they could, at this point, they could make a decision as an application, okay, I got this and this IP address, so which interface would I actually prefer? And then it would connect to the server over this IP address and then close the socket, like after doing whatever the application wants to do. So this is all good, but now we have many applications on the client. And if we think about that, every application would have to implement its own decision logic to differentiate between the interfaces and to pick one of the interfaces or the other. And then also sometimes it's important what is the current performance of the interface. And so imagine that every application would have to periodically like monitor the interfaces, gather some statistics on it, which one is currently used the most, or maybe did I lose my did I lose performance, or is the Wi-Fi congested, something like this. So one problem would be that a lot of code would have to be duplicated within all the applications, and it would also get really complicated. And the other one is that so if we then try to unify this in some way, which is what we are doing with the Socket Intents framework, then you, on the other hand, you have the problem that the applications do have different requirements. Like if you just provide one single API and you say, okay, so now at one central library, we always make the decision which interface would be better in this case, then maybe the same default interface doesn't always work for the different applications with their different needs and different kinds of traffic that they have. And so in the Socket Intents framework, we are trying to basically substitute this socket interface by a more enhanced API and provide a framework that manages different network interfaces and that that can make decisions for the applications which of the available interfaces to use for example, the next connection. So I'm going to explain how this works in a little more detail. So first, socket intents is a concept about the different requirements and needs of the applications. So by default, through the socket interface, the application can only basically say, okay, I want a TCP connection, I want a UDP connection, which is nice, but over this connection, there can be lots of different things, right? It can just be like some small and short queries that just have to be finished like as fast as possible. It could also be a huge file transfer, and it could also be like a long-lived video streaming session. So one socket intent that we introduce, which is a piece of additional information that the application can give to the library, to the socket intents libraries through the enhanced socket API, is about the category of the traffic. So for example, is it a query, is it a stream, is it a bulk transfer? So we can differentiate between like different connections that the application opens when we make our decisions later. And another intent would be the object size of the transfer. Like if it's a transfer, then are we talking about a 10 kilobyte object, or are we talking about 1 megabyte or 100 megabyte? Then also something about the duration. Like is there a fixed duration that we know this connection is gonna last? And then also about the timeliness, which we named it, which is basically, is it a time-critical traffic? Is it going to be something that the user is going to be interacting with, or is it just in the background and we don't care if it's finished within 5 minutes or 10 minutes? Sorry. So all these pieces of information are optional, but the application can specify them as additional hints to the socket intents library. And can do this in the hope that then the library can like make a better decision on which of the available interfaces would fit the requirements of the new connection from the application. So this is not quality of service. So there are no service guarantees. It's not intended that you specify, I need 10 megabit per second guaranteed bandwidth, but more like, okay, I would like some kind of like duration of a stream transfer, and maybe you can set a bitrate, but it's not about guaranteeing anything. It's about the best effort of the system. And also if multiple applications would set these intents, then the system would have to balance their requirements in a fair way. So it's not about quality of service, and it's also not about prioritization, that one application says, okay, my traffic is now the most important. So yeah, this is the concept of socket intents, and now we are building resilience to connection loss, I forgot. So it's also a question of, if this TCP connection was to be interrupted, how bad would it be? Is it just a transfer I can resume, or is it like a stream that would get interrupted for the user? So our socket intents library basically is sitting on top of the usual socket library that I already showed. And the application would first use this, and so then the socket library, the socket intents library, talks to the multi-access manager, which is a standalone application. It's like a daemon that runs once for the whole system, and it gathers performance estimates from the interfaces that are currently configured. And then later on, it has the task to choose an interface. So how it works is that there is an application that uses the socket intents library. And yeah, it makes a request. It says, okay, I want to set up a new connection with these particular features or intents. Or like, this is my idea of what to optimize for in this connection. And then the socket intents library queries the multi-access manager, says, okay, so this is all the application that I got from the information. Which interface do I use for it? What do you think? And then the multi-access manager has a policy, which is a module that can be dynamically loaded. So also in different environments, you can use different policies for choosing your interfaces. For example, the multi-access manager would then say, okay, you should use WLAN0 for this connection, and it sends this information back to the socket intents library, which can then bind the connection to WLAN0 and connect the socket. So this is in a little more detail. So the application starts up, and then the policy on the right, which runs within the multi-access manager, also starts up. And then the application can, for example, already specify its intents on some data structure that we pass to all our socket calls, which are like not on the slide, but we have to link the socket calls all together in some way. And for example, you can do it by handling socket context for like the same connection. So you can do some set sock opt call that we extended by the socket intents. And then when the application does get other info to resolve a name, the intents library makes the policy resolve that name. So why do we need name resolution here? Well, if you have multiple access networks which you connect to, then the same server might be reachable like over both interfaces, but also maybe you're talking to a content delivery network, and then there is multiple servers for the same host name. And then if you do a get other info over one interface, you get maybe a different set of IP addresses than if you do it over the other interface. And to our knowledge, there is not yet software in Linux that handles this like explicitly, that you can get different resolver responses over different interfaces. And then how do you manage it? Like if you then establish the connection later over one interface, but you get you use the IP address that you have resolved over the other interface, maybe your performance could suffer from it. And so this is what we're trying to address here, when we already resolve the name in the policy and already choose some destination IP. So basically, you could issue a DNS request over both interfaces at the same time and see which comes first, or you could just make a decision and then choose which IP address to actually give back through the library to the application. And at that point, the application can set up its socket and then do a connect. So the application now does not have to call bind explicitly, but it can just call connect, because the socket intents library internally handles the connect and like sends the connect request to the policy, which would then choose one of the local interfaces or choose the IP address that the intents library then binds the socket to, which already exists at that point. And then the application can do something on the socket and close the socket later. So yeah, this is the rather like basic classic socket API, which is also unfortunately blocking. We also have a few non-blocking libraries or APIs though for applications. And we, for example, have Socket Connect, which is another API that basically we developed. And the idea is that here we wanted to have just one call for the application, that the application can say, hey, I want to connect to this URL on this port and with this intents for the connection. And then the socket intents library would give back a socket that is already connected to the application. Or it would, if it's non-blocking, it would just give back like a placeholder that is going to be connected later, and then the application can later use the socket, like by Paul. And so the socket connect works kind of similarly, but the resolving and choosing of the destination IP and local IP address basically happen all in one call to the policy. So when it's called the very first time, then there is no existing socket. So the policy would basically find out the parameters for the socket that the application should use. And then the socket intents library sets up the socket and gives it back to the application. So now the application can use the socket for read, write, whatever. And then it does not have to close it yet. It can also use a socket release, which says, okay, let's leave this socket open, but I don't need it anymore for now. And then for the next socket connect, the application might get the same socket back, but it might also get back a different socket, like a new socket, for example. So here we can have several sockets that the socket instance library manages for the application. And the application can just say, okay, now I want a socket that is suitable for this intent, and now there's a socket that is suitable for like a different intent, and then it doesn't have to care which interface it is. It can just use the socket that it gets from the intents library. So for example, if we have two interfaces and there is a TCP connection over one interface and there's one over the other interface, then you could do one HTTP request over the one TCP connection, you could do the next request over the other connection and like use them in parallel. And also this works when you have more streams or when you have more TCP connections. So usually there would be like a number of connections open over both interfaces. And then for each request, like for example, if you're in a web browser and you're fetching a website with different objects, then you can fetch object one over like one interface and the next object over another connection over the same interface or maybe over a different interface. So with Socket Connect, you manage a set of sockets and the application doesn't have to consider which interface to use because it just always gets back a socket that it can use to read or write on. Most likely just first a write and then a read. Anyway, so but the Socket Connect API exists in different variants. And yeah, but the details are, for example, in the draft that I linked on the page of the talk, and I can also give you the details if you're interested later. So these are two APIs that we developed, and then we also developed policies, which were the component just on the right that we saw. They are they get as input the socket intents per connection or maybe per message, per object, what the application wants to do. And then also it gathers the interface statistics passively. So right now we just observe existing traffic over the interface and we see like, okay, what are the round trip times of the TCP connections that already exist, what is like the minimum, what is the median, and try to guess something from these round-trip times. And also we observe the interface counters and basically see, okay, what is the maximum change in interface counter, which means like used bandwidth, like sent or received bytes that we see like per 100 milliseconds. And then we can have a guess about the capacity of the interface, like the maximum download or upload bandwidth over the interface. And from these inputs, we can now choose a local interface. So simple baselines to compare against would be that we use only one of the interfaces, or that we use both, like one after the other, in like a round robin fashion. So first interface one, then interface two, then one and two, and so on. Like always go back and forth. And then also we could have a policy that just always picks the interface with the lower RTT, or that always picks the interface with the higher bandwidth. And then one policy that we developed is the earliest predicted arrival time, or early arrival policy. And this one would now make use of the intent called object size. So the idea behind that is that if you have a large object, then you want to prefer the interface with the high bandwidth. But if you have a small object, then the interface with a lower RTT, if it's a different interface, would be more beneficial. Because for the small object, you don't actually need a high bandwidth, but you just want the download to be finished as fast as possible. But for the larger objects, a higher bandwidth is important, because otherwise you will have to wait longer for your object. And so the policy basically tries to predict based on the interface statistics that it got previously. It tries to predict how long will I need over one interface, how long do I need over the other interface, and so which one do I prefer in this case. And then also, as I said already, it can choose a remote IP address among multiple resolved IP addresses, and also set arbitrary socket options. Actually, we also have we have the option to switch on or to enable multipath TCP per connection. This is not something I evaluated yet, but we also built this into the prototype, so also the prototype is still being extended with like some of these nice features. So now I'm going to show you an evaluation setup that I'm currently working with. It's also fairly simple. So I don't use an actual LTE network, but I have a Wi-Fi and then an internet connection from a laptop that is going via a traffic shaper and then to a server. So the client runs a web browser and it uses the socket intents framework for its connections. And then the traffic shaper can emulate different network conditions, like you can specify an RTT that is imposed on all the traffic that goes through one of these networks, and you can shape the bandwidth, like you can limit the bandwidth that can go through the shaper, and also you can configure packet loss on the traffic. So I emulate different network conditions on both paths, basically. And then there's the web server, which can which hosts different web pages of different sizes. And so far, it's just a static workload, like just some websites with a number of images, which I'm going to show you on the next slide. So this is going to be the details of like a preliminary evaluation that I'm doing right now, because right now I'm still like trying out which are the best policies and how to optimize the performance, for example, for web browsing. So in this case, the connection on the top in green is over the Wi-Fi interface, and it has a shaped RTT of only 10 milliseconds, so it's quite fast, but also it only has 2 megabit per second as a download bandwidth, which is like not a lot. And in blue on the bottom over the Ethernet, I shaped a RTT of 100 milliseconds, but of 20 megabit per second downstream. So here again, the idea is that for very small queries, very small objects. You would prefer the one in green with the Wi-Fi interface with 10 milliseconds. And for larger objects, you would prefer the one with 20 megabit per second download, because it's that would be the faster one in each case. So the websites, I have more websites, but these are the ones that I'm going to be showing in the plot on the next slide. Is there's a one static website where it's one HTML file, and then for 10 kilobyte images or 10 kilobyte images or 16 images or for 100 kilobyte images. And usually web pages are going to be more objects and of bigger sizes, but yeah, the evaluation is going to continue in that direction to more realistic workloads and websites. And then the policies that I used for this preliminary evaluation that I'm going to be showing is only over one interface, WLAN 0, only over ETH 0, the other interface, and then both with the earliest arrival policy that for each of the objects predicts the download time and then uses either WLAN 0 or ETH 0. So here is my plot. So on the x-axis, you see the different scenarios. Like this is 10 kilobyte 4 images, 10 kilobyte 8 images, 10 kilobyte 16, and 100 kilobyte 4 images. And basically always the socket intents, then ETH 0 only, and then WLAN 0 only. And on the y-axis is the page load time in seconds, and it's like between 0.3 and 1.8 or so seconds for this particular quite small workload. So these are box plots. So they show of many repetitions. They show you the median, basically, and then in some cases, like from where to where did we see values. So for the very small page of only 4 images of 10 kilobyte, ETH 0 was apparently quite fast, because lower is better, of course, for page load time. And WLAN 0 was slower, and then socket intents used ETH 0, the faster interface, basically. ETH 0 is better also in this case. So WLAN is slower, so socket intents uses the better interface. But then, as the images get more or the workload gets bigger, at some point, WLAN, which had the higher bandwidth, becomes better. Because if we are going to download many more images, then at some point, the bandwidth is going to get clogged on the 2 megabyte interface. And so here, Socket Intents uses the WLAN 0 interface, because it's faster. And then the last case is particularly nice, because here we use a combination. So this one is up here. The ETH 0 interface has now become actually quite slow, because it has only 2 megabyte per second download bandwidth, and WLAN is way faster. But then Socket Intents is even faster, because it can make use of both interfaces. And so, as I said, this is only a preliminary evaluation, and right now I'm working on a like more extensive one and improving my policies and the matrix and performance estimates that I get from the interfaces. So so keeping in mind that this is a research prototype and not a production code, still I'm wondering if, like, okay, so for socket intents, the application needs to be modified. I'm aware that this is going to be quite hard. Like, I'm not expecting that every browser is going to support socket intents in the future, but still, it's a question of like how to get applications to use socket intents or something like this, or how should the application, if it should do it, communicate its needs or expectations about the traffic, and then also how to come up with smarter policies to choose between network interfaces, and also, which I find an interesting question, how to integrate this with other Linux user space software or what networking libraries exist that could inform the socket intents framework, or vice versa, or yeah, how does it work? So if anybody has any input or questions on this, I'm looking forward to that. So this is my summary. So the goal of my research is to use multiple network interfaces. The prototype we developed is called Socket Intents. It's a networking library in user space, which applications can use to specify what it knows about its traffic, and then to get its interface picked, basically through the multi-access manager, which chooses the best option. And the code is on GitHub, and it's released under a BSD license. So you can check it out, you can play around with it. And yeah, you can talk to us about it. So for contacting me, Teresa@inet, because it's like part of my research, but I'm also on Twitter and I'm on Mastodon. So if you don't know Mastodon already, you should check it out, because actually on Mastodon I write more technical stuff, and on Twitter it's more like activism. So it's Mastodon is basically Twitter, but better. So enough ads. Okay, and then I'm also on LinkedIn if that's your thing, or I'm also on GitHub. All right, so thank you for your attention. And now I think we have a little time for questions, if there are any. 7 minutes, I see. Yeah.
Hello, my name is Luba. I work on Network Manager, so this sort of interests me, what you mm-hmm. said. I do have a question. I'm wondering, you said you do passive monitoring to assess the properties of the interfaces mm-hmm. that for the policy to take decisions, and I'm wondering, how does this work, like from the very beginning? Like when you, mm-hmm. I suppose you don't have any information then, so suppose you start with a slow mobile broadband, and the gigabit Ethernet, do the round robin from the beginning?
So what we do is that in the multi-access manager, we have this callback, which currently gets invoked every 100 seconds, and then it basically reads out all the statistics, like through netlink and from the interface counters that it can find. But we assume that there is already ongoing traffic on the system, and it needs to be bootstrapped somehow. And I guess for the first peer request, we should use a sort of round robin, but like, this kind of thing is what I'm like currently still working on. Like, what is the best way to gather these statistics? I also think that this kind of thing could be like coordinated between different processes that actually have an interest in like which interface is the best. Also, we monitor some Wi-Fi statistics. Like through Netlink, you can get signal strength and the currently used or the last used modulation rate. And also, we are working on looking into how we can get the QBSS information, like from the access point, which can insert basically the current utilization of the channel, which is really interesting, because the signal strength, it can like up to a point, it doesn't matter so much if the signal strength is really good or not so good, but the utilization of the medium, like how many clients are there and how much traffic are they sending, is really interesting. And so like we're also gathering these kinds of statistics. Thanks. You also had a question?
So did I get it right that it's for client side of the connection, or it might be also useful for server side?
It could also be used for server side. So the library is not limited to that. So for example, it could also be used in like in a data center where there's a multi-homed server that wants to open like different connections for different kinds of workloads. So I haven't explored that yet, and I'm like more interested in the client side, but yeah, I think it would be possible. I don't know about the exact like networking libraries that exist for the server side, but I guess it would be possible. As long as you at some point either establish a connection or you say, okay, now I have something, like some traffic to send, now I have something to do, please give me a socket to do it. It should be possible. Yeah.
I was wondering about if you've got a lot of interfaces, especially if you've got also open VPN interfaces, these, those pseudo interfaces, is this library smart enough to, well, basically use the right one? Because if you're using OpenVPN, you don't want things to go over the unencrypted channel.
Yeah, sure. Yes, you could configure these things in the policy. So in the policy, you can configure which interface you want to have considered at all. So you, if you have an interface that you deem insecure, then you wouldn't consider it at all, maybe. And we don't have a security intent so far, but we could add it.
I was wondering if you tested you did some simulation with limited bandwidth, for example. Do you change that limit over time? Or?
Not yet, but yeah, that's also something that is planned because, of course, mobile performance can also be very flaky. But what we did do is that we introduced cross traffic on the wireless channel from multiple clients, and then, of course, we see the performance drastically drop. Like, no matter what is shaped later on, if there is many clients on your channel or if your signal gets bad, then at some point you're gonna like see the performance change. But with these dynamic network conditions, it's also an interesting question. So I set this framework up, and now I can play around with like lots of different scenarios. Oh, there's one.
Have you tried to model what kind of effects, in the case of the Wi-Fi and the LTE, which is, I suspect, a very common case, have you tried to model what kind of effects it would have if you turn this on? Because, you know, LTE is generally more of a scarce resource. Mm-hmm. So if everyone started acting like rationally but selfishly, would you come, you know, do you think you'd come into a situation where the overall network is worse overall because everybody's acting rationally?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have looked into started considering some communication with the network. Like, of course, from the access point, we can have the medium utilization, but from the LTE network, I think we don't get as much information, right? But then, I already looked into how you could coordinate different clients, but I like don't have a ready simulation of it yet. But it's also an interesting question. Also, there is one socket intent that I didn't mention that is basically about for this connection, would it be okay to use something that costs money or like that uses up your mobile data thing or not? And so this we also have like in mind.
Have you given it some thought how you would integrate this with application sandboxing? Especially mobile devices, you generally don't want applications accessing through arbitrary network interfaces, but rather whitelisted one.
So mobile sandboxing we haven't done yet so far. Our prototype runs on a notebook with either like Linux or macOS, and I'm mostly with Linux. Yeah, but you have to figure out, in the policy, you would have to figure out these kinds of things, I think. Like, what are the needs of the application, and what are the system-wide policies, and what are the users' preferences, but also how much is who able to control. So this kind of policy framework, with all the different inputs to the potential policies, is something that I'm also exploring right now. And also, my colleague and I are participating in the TUPS working group at the IETF, which is about choosing between different transport protocols mostly. But there we also have like some kind of, okay, what is the policy? Like, when do we use what kind of transport protocol, and what are the different inputs? So we are also like discussing this with like the wider community, like what are policies and how do they work? Yeah, thanks. So I think we had one more minute, but if there's no more questions here, I'm also happy to chat about this later on. Thank you.